the Connect NC bond this morning, especially with the resolution. What do you want people to take home from that? I know we had quite a few points in the resolution, but what do you want people to take home?
I think the big point for our own particular bond package is that we're really hoping that we can get the support because it will allow us to continue to train more doctors for the state. There's a critical need for more doctors. They need to be outstanding doctors. We've got the capacity to do it, and we need to really improve the facility. The second really big point is that this bond won't increase taxes, and it has some very important facilities for every single one of our universities and our community colleges. So it is a huge investment in the future of the state that touches all counties and is going to make a real difference in a very fast time. So we're excited about it. We're grateful to the people of the state for their support of it.
Everyone's affected by health care. As you saw by the numbers, by the year 2020, the expectation is about a third of the doctors in North Carolina are going to be at retirement age. It's vital that we refill those positions and even add more because our population is continuing to increase as North Carolina is an attractive state for people to come and live.
When you hear from students like Ashley, kind of be able to tell you in a little more tangible detail of the difference of what they need today and how everything is taught differently, how does that impact you as you take that message out to potential voters?
Well, I thought Ashley was very compelling, and I thought, in fact, all three of the speakers really made one of the most important points. Healthcare is a team-based endeavor now. It is highly connected technologically, and in good healthcare practice, you start early. You start learning very quickly. And as they pointed out, these old buildings are designed for a time when that is not how we educate. So I think she did that so perfectly, and she brought to life the idea that she's in her second semester, and she's already out working in a clinic. You know, I think that interactive, team-based education is so important, and everyone can really relate to the difference that the facilities make in making that educational opportunity and experience better.
I would say with the advent of technology, the way that we teach differently now, those classrooms that we presently have are just not suitable for the way that medical students need to be taught.
Chancellor, at the Board of Governors meeting, Budget Committee, there was mention made that a couple of large campuses in the system are beginning to look at the idea of privatizing the development and operation of their student housing. And I haven't heard where UNC Chapel Hill is one of them, but I'm just wondering if that's a concept that the administration has any interest in exploring or.
It's not on my radar. I haven't been following it at the other institutions. It's not something that we're talking about.
Okay.
Chancellor, I wanted to ask you about the steps you announced this week on campus climate issues and some of the changes you're going to be making there and where you see that going. You said these are sort of the first steps. What do you think of these steps you're taking and where does it go in the future?
Well, I'm really excited about it. And when I say the first steps, there's a lot that we're already undertaking. So I think we'll, you know, as you work on things, other things become necessary. But, you know, some of the things that we announced are things that we've been doing. Others were very much informed by the meetings with students, with faculty. And I'm giving you an example. We heard a lot from people that they wanted to be able to host difficult conversations. These issues on race are difficult to have, and they're happening around the country. So already, the Ethics Institute has launched a series of classroom opportunities for graduate students and faculty to come and work with them to learn how to host those conversations and do them in ways that are fruitful and productive. That's just one example of something that's launching almost immediately, coming out of the task force, the work that they're doing. They're working on aspects that have to do with healthcare. Students and others have been saying they need more access to some of those facilities. We've got ideas there. They're working on ways to have space. We're looking at naming opportunities. So, you know, the list goes on. I think the idea that we've been asked to create a web presence. You know, we're a big university with many schools and many ideas and many working groups, and it is overwhelming to try to find your way. You know, how do you even find out about that course that's being taught? Do you have to know the Ethics Institute? You know, these steps are hard for people. So one of the things that's been asked by everybody is make it easier. So we've already got people working on creating a new web portal. That means that every time you want to know about this, you can go to a single place and get access to the things that are happening, and then have places to put in requests for other types of opportunities you'd like to see take place. So that's just some of them. There are faculty groups working on educational opportunities, thinking about training. You heard that the whole senior leadership team and the board are all going to be taking some more training and having opportunities to talk about it. So I just feel like it's a great extension, and we'll keep people apprised of all the new things as we move forward.
Yes, before Dr. Ehrman spoke, you mentioned bringing in more humanities and social sciences perspectives, and I just want to know what that effort looks like and what does that mean for the board to hear from non-scientific perspectives.
Well, I was going to say, that would be to mischaracterize. We bring them in all the time. Mm-hmm. We do. But people had recently said, you know, we brought in the arts, we bring in social science. We do. We have a diversity every time. But sometimes we do tend to focus on the immediacy. You know, what's happening right now in medical care, or how is it changing in business? And one really great thing is to go back and talk about some of the basic, the fundamental studies. And the study of religion is an example. I think he talks about a course about the history and the roots of Christianity. And so the board said, let's hear about that too. And so that was a great opportunity for us. And I think the chair and the other board members often have ideas about areas of the institution they want to hear more. And then we quickly and easily find people that want to speak. But this was really in direct response to tell us about areas that we might not be jumping to the public attention immediately, yet are really important to our students and our faculty. Is that how you see it?
Absolutely. And the fact of the matter is we have so many, and I'll call them hidden gems here at the university. I mean, we just got one taste of it with a religion professor who's written 31 books, who's nationally known, who's a great scholar. And those kinds of people are across our faculty, and we're very proud of it.
All right. Thanks, folks.